OK. Bonjour tout le monde. Maintenant, on va parler un peu du Québec. Et on a Marie Lapointe. Merci d'être ici, de Montréal.
Merci.
De faire le voyage. If you want to listen to this panel in English, it's going to be a bilingual panel. Just go to Hopin and go to the right part of your Hopin and do the scroll down. And it says French, and there you'll get a bilingual presentation of what Marie speaks about.
And we can translate as well.
And we can translate as well.
No problem.
Donc, merci. Marie Lapointe est la présidente du Hydrogène Québec. Pas Hydro-Québec, mais Hydrogène Québec. Et on sait que le Québec est très fort dans cette transition pour le vert et pour l'environnement. Pour commencer, Marie, qu'est-ce que vous voyez en ce moment pour le succès de l'hydrogène? How will hydrogen be one of the solutions that we look for?
Ben, en fait, c'est la troisième vague de l'hydrogène. Il y a eu des efforts il y a 20 ans, il y a 10 ans, mais là, c'est vraiment le temps. This is really a revolution. And why? Because hydrogen is a key factor, a key energy vector to push the petrol and diesel. So we have the opportunity to do a real transition, energy transition, and create a new governance for sustainability. C'est vraiment fantastique parce que on a beaucoup de diversité énergétique au Canada et au Québec, on est capable de produire de l'hydrogène vert à bas carbone à partir de l'électrolyse de l'eau. Donc, on peut briser la molécule de H2O. We can break with electricity the molecule of water. Then we have hydrogen and we generate oxygen. So it's fantastic and it's possible to do that with electricity from renewable energy. Second, it's possible also to do blue hydrogen in Alberta and in the west of Canada. Et comment ça se fait? Il y a eu une présentation tout à l'heure pour expliquer ça, de capturer le carbone.
So let's put that slide up because it really shows what's happening in the world in terms of global markets or potential markets. There's one slide before this, if we can show it.
Yeah.
Yeah. There we go. So this one's really interesting. So it just shows green hydrogen, blue hydrogen, and gray hydrogen. And we're seeing the projects being greenlit around the world. Donc, Marie, on voit le petit point vert au Québec,
uh-huh.
qui est l'hydrogène vert.
Mais qui va devenir gros.
C'est ça. Voilà. Et puis, on voit le point bleu pour l'hydrogène bleu en Alberta. Donc, on voit que le Canada est là, mais on voit que le monde est en avance en ce moment.
Oui. On n'est pas en retard, mais on n'est pas en avance. Et il y a des raisons pour ça. So at the left, you have the demand by 2050. And at the right, you have the supply. What is interesting is that we need hydrogen to decarbonize economy. And we want to be carbon neutral by 2050. It won't be done by magic. It will be done by strategy and by a clear path and a new governance of working with finance, innovation, environment, and social. So if you see here, 95% of the hydrogen is gray today, produced by petrol, fossil. So the transition will be with blue, using petroleum, but capturing CO2, as the presentation we have. And then we will move gradually to green hydrogen or low carbon hydrogen by electrolysis of water or by pyrolysis. Donc, on peut dire hydrogène vert ou hydrogène turquoise ou hydrogène rose qui est du nucléaire. Les gens ont différentes couleurs. No, anyway. Why is it so exciting? The demand will double every 10 years up to until 2050. And why is it so exciting in Canada? Because we have a lot of energy, a lot of potential. Quand j'entendais ce matin que parce qu'il y avait différents portfolios au Canada, c'était un désavantage. Pour nous, bon, je fais partie de l'Association canadienne d'hydrogène, CHFCA, c'est un avantage, c'est une richesse. La main-d'œuvre qualifiée qu'on a, c'est une richesse. Les industries minières qu'on a, qu'on peut décarboner et garder au Canada, ça va être une richesse. Et en plus, pour les collectivités, qu'est-ce que ça veut dire? Ça veut dire qu'ils vont pouvoir enfin être capables d'avoir des systèmes éoliens et des systèmes solaires, puis être capables d'avoir de l'hydrogène pour stocker l'énergie intermittente. Donc, c'est vrai, et gérer leur collectivité, puis gérer leur énergie. Donc, moi, je vois au contraire que ça va diminuer la main-d'œuvre, puis l'employment, il y a les emplois au Canada, ça devrait permettre de les maintenir. So, ça, c'est la première chose. If you see the bubbles in Europe, what is interesting is that they don't have energy in Europe. They import energy from Middle East, from Russia, from the Scandinavia. So what are they doing? They create a lot of Aeolian and solar. We have seen that today. And they want to use the hydrogen to transport the energy and to store the energy. So in Canada, we have a big, big advantage. It's so important that Germany have invested 9 billion of euro for the next 5 years in hydrogen. France, they invest 7 billion for the next 5 years in hydrogen. UK has invested 4.8 billion of pounds in hydrogen. Why? They want our energy. They want our hydrogen. So the question we need to ask is, before selling to Asia, to Europe, and to US, do we want to use this hydrogen to decarbonize our economy and our activities? It will create a lot of jobs. If we see the other...
Sure, let's move to the next slide because it's very interesting as well, which just shows, you know, hydrogen's kind of nowhere, right, on the 2017 slide. It's something that's been studied and looked at but has never really kind of taken off. But you're projecting by 2050 that it's going to have a huge chunk of the market.
Yes, I love this slide. It's not a trivial pursuit. It's from Daniel Lazel in the west of Canada. He's a really good consultant. He knows energy very well. And you see at the middle the portfolio of the current portfolio of Canada of energy. So it's electricity, and this is fossil. And you see what could look like the portfolio of energy in 2050. Alors, c'est vraiment intéressant parce que vous voyez que ça va être 30% d'électricité, 30% d'hydrogène, en fait, qui va remplacer, les biofuels qui vont être produits beaucoup par un mix d'hydrogène. Et aussi, l'hydrogène, c'est ça peut être utilisé comme matière première pour décarboner la présentation qu'on vient d'avoir d'agriculture, le méthanol, l'ammoniac et l'éthanol. Vous savez, on produit l'hydrogène depuis 100 ans pour l'agriculture, for fertilizer. But it's 3% of the CO2 in the world. Can you imagine if we use that in Canada and we produce hydrogen and green hydrogen and low carbon hydrogen to change completely the fertilizers with green methanol, low carbon ethanol, low carbon ammoniac. So it's a big, big change. So you can see that maybe we will have just 25 current residual activities, but low carbon intensity of fuel, and maybe 5% of the current fuel fossil production. So it's a big, big shift of paradigms. In order to go there, what do we need? We need a pool system. So first, we need innovation. And innovation, we need public-private dedicated funds to do that. In Quebec and in Canada, we are good in R&D. And people and organisms are good to work with big companies and little scale-up and startups, because the PME, they innovate. So we need money with them. And last week, 2 weeks ago, we met Airbus. They are really interested, as was explaining this morning, to produce fuel, biofuel and biocarburant and synthetic carburant. And it will be done with a sub-products of ethanol, green ethanol, soon, because they want to have the plane for 2035. This is tomorrow for them. And the next plane will be with fuel cells on the plane. 2 days ago, we had a webinar with Alstom. They have developed trains with hydrogen. And it's fantastic, because can you imagine that we can bring that with the current infrastructure of rails? It could be fantastic. But we will need infrastructure. We need $170 per ton of CO2 credits. We need to have targets of zero vehicle emissions because the technology are there. We need to invest massively in the batteries. And I like that because with Accelerator, the new alliance of Accelerator, we want to go from mine to batteries and to use the mines that we have here in Canada and the products to produce the batteries and to recirculate them. We need also the credits because we need to give incentives to the companies because we want them to stay. I worked 25 years for Alcan and Rio Tinto, you know? And we have a big chance for the perennity of the big organizations because if they decarbonize, they will have a strategic advantage on the market. They can sell decarbonized iron bullets. They can sell decarbonized steel plates. They can sell, why not in the cementeries? We could capture the CO2 in the cementeries. Aluminium is another way, a big CO2 emitter, and they have a lot of plans. But all the big companies, they have a commitment to go and decarbonize by 2050. But they hesitate, you know, because we need to say to them, let's see, we will find mechanisms at the height of $170 per ton, and you will be able to use that in OPEX or in CAPEX, but you need to invest and take risk. And I think that this is a good way to find and to keep industry in Canada. If they are decarbonized, they will remain. And they will still operate in Canada. We should say, hey, come in Canada and decarbonize here. We have the good structure for that.
Donc on a le temps pour une autre question. Donc c'est quoi le plus gros obstacle que vous passez en ce moment et comment est-ce que vous pouvez améliorer la situation? What's the biggest obstacle you face and what would be the biggest way to get through it?
Je pense que ça va être d'avoir des fonds dédiés et d'asseoir tout le monde autour de la table. On a besoin d'avoir Shell avec nous, ils font déjà partie de l'association canadienne, d'avoir les Sonic, d'avoir les compagnies Arnois, d'avoir Irving, d'avoir Suncor. Parce qu'ils ont le capital, puis ils savent que ça s'en vient. On a besoin d'avoir les industriels, parce qu'ils ont des plans, mais ils ont besoin d'aide, ils ne le feront pas tout seuls. Le gouvernement ne pourra pas le faire tout seul non plus. So we need public-private funds to do that, and we need communities that will be involved. And that they can find prosperities. Yesterday we had a great presentation from an autochthon person, you know, and they manage their energy portfolio. So when you have autochthon people on governance on your board, you don't have to explain to them what is circular economy. They know that for millionaires. Okay? And we need maybe to change ourselves. When I see the room, when I see the boards, 5 years ago, I did a course at McGill in governance. And we were all boomers or just next like me. And, you know, and I found during the simulations, all the best solutions came from people from HR or NGO or environment. So we need to change ourselves. We need to incorporate a lot of new people. People that are not, for the time being, inborn. We are engineers, we are accountants, we need social workers, we need autochthon, we need HR people, we need archaeologists. So I decided to study and to do a new bac at University of Montreal in history and anthropology. And next spring I will have my bac.
Good for you.
Because it changed completely my mindset.
Yeah. So rather than looking at the challenge, looking at it from a different way, that's what Dax Da Silva talked about with his art history.
I think this is our big challenge, change our mindset and all work together. But you know, I think that, as we said, we need to have a permanent committee with policies that won't change from one government to another. And I think that I don't want to do politics, but I think that we have a chance now to be sure that finance will work with innovation, that will work with environment, with the recent announcement, and with social.
Excellent. Donc, merci, Marie, et merci pour votre conversation.
Merci beaucoup.
Okay.